Thanks, everybody, for coming to another edition of Math Encounters. Tonight, I'm delighted that we have as an introducer Jason Rosenfeld. And Jason has a very exciting job title. He's the director of analytics for the NBA, the director of basketball analytics, I should say. And for those young people in the audience who might aspire to one day work for the NBA, I can assure you that getting a degree in math and statistics is probably a surer route to the NBA than trying to become a pro ball player. So with that, I give you Jason.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Cindy. Unfortunately, there are actually more NBA players than NBA statisticians, so I don't know if she's correct, but hopefully one day the ratio will change. So as she said, my name is Jason Rosenfeld. I work for the NBA League Office here in Midtown Manhattan. And before I joined the league office, I was with the Charlotte Bobcats, now the Charlotte Hornets, one of our NBA teams down in Charlotte, North Carolina, also working in basketball analytics. And before that, I spent a year actually in China working for a professional basketball team there. So I'll be talking about basketball analytics, but before I get into that, I just want to talk briefly about baseball analytics, because the sports analytics revolution really started with baseball. So a guy by the name of Bill James began researching the game in an innovative way, right? So for a long time, people said, this guy looks like a player, this guy doesn't look like a player. He actually was relying on the data to determine if a player is good or not, and he was using objective means, okay? And he was able to determine that statistics such as on-base percentage were more valuable than batting average, okay? So his main conclusion, the conventional wisdom, was wrong, okay? One of the reasons that the sports analytics revolution started with baseball is that baseball is much more amenable to statistical analysis than other sports like basketball. And that's primarily because baseball is pretty much a one-on-one game, right? It's pitcher versus batter. You don't have much interactions. It's very much discrete, right? It's pitch, it's strike, it's ball, it's hit, it's stolen base, whereas other sports are much different. Okay. If you look at basketball, if you look at a single play when a guy makes a jump shot, it's still hard to determine who deserves the credit, right? You have 10 guys on the court, but how do you divvy up credit? Should you give the majority of the credit to the guy who made the shot, or should you give credit to the guy who passed him the ball, or the guy who set a good screen, or the coach who drew up a good play, or the defender who didn't help the helper? I mean, it's pretty complicated. Okay, and that's why basketball is a much harder sport to analyze, but also one that I find much more exciting. Okay, fortunately, the daunting task of studying basketball statistics hasn't scared away a lot of fans. And if the baseball statistical revolution took place in the 90s and early 2000s, the basketball one has taken place in the past 5 to 7 years. Okay, so a lot of fans, teams, media have invested a lot in trying to use data to better understand the sport. Fortunately for them, they have a lot better data to work with. Okay, so back in 2005, a group of Israeli scientists created a technology known as SportView, and they created this to track missiles in Israel. Okay, the company named Stats, based in Chicago, bought the software and turned their attention to basketball. Okay. Instead of using the technology to track missiles, they determined they would use the technology to track players, okay, and the basketball. In any case, they determined that they would use the technology to track the players and the basketball. And the technology, their cameras at the top of every single NBA arena now, 6 cameras at the top of every NBA arena, and they take photographs of the players throughout the game, okay? And you know 25 times per second the XY coordinates of every human being on the court and the XYZ coordinate of the ball, okay? So at the end of the game, as you might imagine, you could learn a lot of interesting things, right? So this is just aerial views from the cameras, and you could basically turn all the players into dots and plot their movement throughout the course of the game, right? So if you want to see the max speed of LeBron James or how many miles Steph Curry ran or the distance between Shane Battier and, you know, Kevin Durant, you could do all that using the data, okay? Now, it's big data sets, because you're getting every player 25 times per second, but you can learn a lot of interesting things. Okay, a group actually at Harvard, they call themselves the XY Hoops Research Group, took this SportView data and did this really tremendous research where they basically said when a player has the ball at the top of the key, he could do one of a bunch of different things. How does the expected point value of the possession change when he does A, B, C, D, or E? Okay? And then based on the decision he actually makes, you could then determine if he made the right decision. Okay? And if you do that for every single player over every single possession, you could then get at who the best decision makers are in the NBA. Okay? Pretty exciting stuff. Just real quick, like I said earlier, I work at the league office now. Before that, I worked for a team. In both cases, you're working with basketball statistics, but the goals are much different, right? So when I was in Charlotte and I was working for a team, the focus was on helping the team win. There, we would use statistics to determine who to pick in the NBA draft, how much to pay free agents, who to trade for, how to prepare for opponents. Again, you're helping the team win, okay? Here at the league office, the goals are much different, right? We're not trying to help a team win. We're really trying to help the NBA win and keep the game healthy and exciting and fun and make sure that it's a product that the fans love now and will always love, okay? So we study a lot of different things there, such as rule changes, player health, scheduling, experimenting with new changes in our D-League, which is our minor league system. And again, it's more on the game as a whole and the direction of it as opposed to helping a single team win, okay? So if you want to learn more about it, fortunately, it's kind of a good time in basketball analytics. I'm hiring at the NBA right now, and a bunch of other departments are too. So if you want to learn more, check out our website. You could email me, and you could let me know any thoughts you might have. And without further ado, I want to introduce our speaker. And his name is Jason Rosenhouse, and we are not related. What are the odds that the introducer the same first name and half of the same last name. So he has a PhD in math from Dartmouth. He's currently a professor of math at James Madison University. He is the author or editor of 5 books. One is called Taking Sudoku Seriously, The Math Behind the World's Most Popular Pencil Puzzle. Another of his books is Among the Creationists, Dispatches from the Anti-Evolutionist Front Lines. Okay? He also has an interesting set of hobbies, which include playing chess, cooking, and reading locked room mysteries. Without further ado, here's Jason Rosenhouse.
Well, okay, well, thank you very much, and thank you for that kind introduction. And let me thank Cindy for this great invitation and the whole technical staff for putting this together, and all of you for coming. I have to tell you, I'm always very excited to come to Manhattan. I live in Harrisonburg, Virginia now, which, let's face it, is the sticks. And so it's always nice to come back to civilization. And and I always, one challenge I always set for myself is that when I come to New York, I always feel like it's a little bit of a scavenger hunt because I have to get the 3 essential food items, right, that you can only get here, right, no place else, right? A pastrami sandwich from Katz's Deli, right? You know, thank you, yeah. Yeah, if you're not applauding, you're really missing out on something. A decent black and white cookie, right? That's you got to get that one, yeah. and a proper slice of pizza, right? Yeah. You do not take that for granted, okay? You know, have Harrisonburg pizza, and then you'll know. I'm not so sure. Bagels are a little too common these days, right? It was a little too much trouble to get down to Katz's this afternoon, so I had lunch at Ben's Deli on 38th Street and 7th, and close enough. That was pretty good. And black and white cookies, there's a bakery right in Penn Station, as I recall, that has very good black and white cookies. So that's 2 down. I haven't figured out the pizza yet, but I'm working on it, right? That's my little New York adventure. I'm here to talk about the Monty Hall problem, and I'll get to that soon enough. But I'd like to start with actually a little demonstration of something, right? The Monty Hall problem is a problem in probability theory, right? And probability theory deals with randomness, right? And randomness is closely related to chaos, okay? And chaos theory is a very trendy thing, right? I'm sure we all saw Jurassic Park, right? So I'd like to give you a demonstration of chaos theory. And I'll use playing cards to do this. And let's see, is this, yeah, okay, good. And so let me show you what I have here. All the tens and the jacks and the queens, and I have the kings and I have the aces. So the tens, jacks, queens, kings, and aces of every suit. Now, if this is going to be a demonstration of chaos theory, though, I need some chaos, right? And this is the opposite of chaos at the moment. This is perfectly sorted. Let me round these up. And it helps to have long fingernails when you do this particular demonstration. Let's see, you're going to be my agents of chaos. Do you have any experienced card handlers in the audience? Anyone's going to shuffle some cards for me? Really, I'm just saying, in the afternoon show, everyone volunteered. Okay, well, you calling up here? Yeah, have we ever met before?
Yes, I'm
Matthew.
Yeah.
Yeah, and a very
effective... same trick you did to me over the week when we visited.
Yes, but these other people don't know me, right? So don't spoil the trick, right? So, let me tell you, my nephew here is a very effective agent of chaos. If you would care to shuffle those up for me. No hurry here, but this is a dead time, right? So, good. Okay, thank you very much. Now, of course, I'm going to get a lot of the rest of you are about to be pressed into service, just so you know, just in case you thought you were going to sit there passively. Let's see here. I need another volunteer. Actually, I think you just made eye contact. Big mistake. You don't have to stand up for this. What is your favorite suit of cards? Spades. Ooh, a fine choice. So this is going to be a demonstration of chaos theory, but I still don't have any. Now, thanks to that extraordinary shuffling job, we're in good shape. But I need a little bit more chaos. So I think what we'll do is maybe if I can start with you, and we'll kind of just go sort of snaking around the audience to make some decisions here. And let's see. I see I have a 10 and a queen here. Which do you like better? Queen. Okay, so I'll leave the queen face up like that. I guess you're next. I have a Jack and a 10 here. Jack. Okay. You know anyone named Jack? I'm just kidding. You have to answer that. Okay, so these cards, are they face up or face down?
Face down.
Face down. Okay. Yeah. And face up or face down? Face up. Okay. Yeah. Probably a psychological tendency in that. But anyway, aces or queens?
Aces.
Aces, yeah. Okay. And you're museum employees, right? So let's get the locals involved, right? So I have a Jack and an Ace here.
Jack.
Jack. Okay. And I have two Aces this time. Face up, face down.
Up.
I believe there's a movie by that title. Okay. And I guess it's your turn. So Adisu, face up, face down.
Down.
And I guess gentlemen there, face up, face down?
Face up.
Face up. And last two, so I have, looks like hearts or clubs. Which do you prefer?
Clubs.
Clubs. Okay, I'll leave the clubs face up. Okay, well, that's pretty chaotic, wouldn't you say? I say, and that's what's important. Okay, so, but I'd like to make this even more chaotic. Now, let's see, I have 20 cards here, right? I just went through by twos. Now I'm going to go through by fours, and I can do that because 20 is a multiple of 2 and 4, okay? Mathematicians call that number theory, okay? So, people get degrees in that. Okay, so, I think it was your turn next. So I'm gonna take these four cards. Should I leave them the way they are or flip them over? Flip them over, you're a radical, okay, you like change. And not the square root kind of radical, right? The political kind of radical, yeah. And I believe it's your turn. Leave them or flip them? Yes, you. Flip them. Now it gets confusing. Okay, so I guess you're next. Nat, right? Leave him or flip him?
Leave him.
Okay. And your turn. Leave him or flip him? Leave them. Okay. And it looks like last choice over here. I think it's your turn.
Leave him.
Okay. Well, that is some serious high-level chaos we have there. So just to see where we stand, I'm going to deal these out. Let's see, where did I leave off? I guess in the blue shirt, you were next. The next row, should I do left to right or right to left? Right to left, okay. Heard someone mention Israel before, right? That's how they do it, right? Okay. I guess your turn, left to right or right to left? Right to left. And last row?
Right to left.
Right to left, okay. Okay, you have no idea the technical staging and hard work that went into getting all those cards to fit in one shot here. As promised, total chaos. And now, after going to all that trouble, though, we're now going to reassemble the deck. We're going to do this in a somewhat unusual way, though. Okay, we're actually going to fold up the deck like a blanket. It'll become clear momentarily what I mean by that. Let's see, did I leave off? You made a choice, right? So I think it's your turn now. You'll notice I have a rectangle here with four edges. Let's call them right, top, left, and bottom. If you could indicate just one of the four edges for me. Bottom. Okay, so here's what I mean by folding it up like a blanket. Okay, we're just going to keep doing that until the whole deck is reassembled. On the end there?
Top.
Okay. And I guess in the next row?
Left.
And whoever was next, I think
left.
It was you. I'm sorry?
Left.
Sometimes these cards want to spin. Okay, at the next choice?
Left
again, okay. And incredibly, we still have four edges. So one more, the next choice?
Right,
okay. Okay, and then I guess the last decision. I guess, are we over here now? Whoever turned, I've lost track. Where are we at? Okay, it was you. So do I flip like this or like this?
Top down.
Okay. If I can do that. Okay. Well, after all of that buildup, after all of that chaos, after all of that randomness, if I told you that all the cards were now facing the same direction, would you be impressed? Would that be a good trick? That would be a good trick, wouldn't it? Yeah. They're not all facing the same direction. That, I haven't figured out how to do that one yet. Well, I could have done that, but that would have been way too easy, right? So instead, let's see where we stand. And it looks like most of the cards are face up, but I do see five face down cards. So let me pull those out. And if you could just remind me what your favorite suit was. Spades. Let's see what we have here. Yeah, come on, yeah. It's okay to be impressed. Thank you very much. Yeah. It's a good trick. The problem with starting with that trick is that I have this terrible fear that that trick is better than my talk. So hopefully the rest of this will not be a letdown. So this is a demo. I'm going to talk about the Monty Hall problem. The Monty Hall problem, of course, is a famous problem of probability theory. And I guess we might as well get right to it. Here is a very precise, technically correct statement of the problem for those who haven't seen before. And you're certainly welcome to read that. I think it's easier, though, if I actually just show you the problem. So what about the big cards for this one? Now, I don't know. I hopefully you in the back can see. As long as you can distinguish red cards from black cards, that will be sufficient. If you can see that there are two red cards and one black card, that will be good enough for what I'm doing. These are the biggest cards I could find, so we'll have to make do. Apparently, I am. By the way, they've told me that I must stay in this box, lest the camera lose me. When I'm moving around. But it is a math talk, so we have some tempo here. Okay, so let me say, who'd like to play the game? Who perhaps has not seen this problem before? I saw a hand up over here, so we'll play around. You can stay in your seat for this one. And I'll give these cards a shuffle. This is a technique I learned from my nephew. And your task is to find the ace of spades here, okay? And we'll imagine that the ace of spades represents a valuable prize and that the two red kings represent less valuable prizes. So we'll do this in two phases. First, I need you to indicate one of these three cards. Make your wishes clear in some way. The middle one. Okay. So then before continuing, I will show you that this one here is actually not the correct choice. Okay, so good job not picking that one. And so now we reach the second phase, right? I will give you your choice. You can either stick with your original card, which was this one, or if you would like, you could switch to this other card, okay? Which would you like to do? You'll stay. Okay. Regrettably, that was not the correct decision. The ace was over here, but thank you for playing. What's your name? Big round of applause for Douglas. That's my middle name. It's not your middle name, too, is it? Okay, yeah, so, okay, because that would just be too weird. Okay, so, yeah, so, So anyway, I don't want to, you know, it's, obviously I can see the front row a little bit better. Is there anyone maybe farther in the back who might want to play around? You got to be careful there. So I thought, yeah. Okay, there we go. So I think we'll be able to do it from there. But let me give the cards a shuffle. And there you are. So if you could just indicate one of the cards for me.
The one on your left.
This one?
Yes.
Okay. So then once again, I will show you before continuing that this one over here was in fact not the right card. Okay, so good job not choosing that one. Did. You know, Captain Spoiler Alert here, right? Yeah. So, yes. So, but I've already forgotten. Which one did you choose first?
The one on your left.
This is the one you choose first. Okay, and you've decided to switch rather ostentatiously, so it serves you right that was the wrong decision. Yeah. And, yeah. It was over here. Okay. Oh, well, maybe we should do one more round. Is anyone else who wants to give this a try? Yeah, I see way in the back there. Yeah, you. I stepped out of the box there. Okay, so you should give me one of those shock collars, right? That's you know, that would get the job done. Yeah. Okay, so we'll do one more round here. Indicate one of the three cards.
The one on your left.
This one.
Yeah.
Okay, so I will show you that this one is in fact not the correct card.
Pardon me.
Okay. And yeah, okay. So once again, this was the one over here that you initially chose. This was the other one. Stick or switch?
My expert advisor over here is telling you to switch.
Switch, and that is a fine choice. Yeah, so finally we have a winner. So between this talk and the first talk, I did this 6 times, you are the only one who won. Yeah, so well done. And I promise you there was no skullduggery, no sleight of hand on my part. Yeah, so. Okay, so that's the game, right? You know, you imagine, the origin of this game, as the slide suggests there, comes from a game show in the 1970s called Let's Make a Deal. The host of that show was Monty Hall, the gentleman up in the picture there, and that is his real name, by the way. That was not a stage. I always, frankly, before I started writing the book, I thought that was just a stage name, but no, that's really his name. And on the game show, the big climactic game that they would play involved a situation very similar to what I just did. You had 3 doors. Behind one of them was a car, right, a very valuable prize. Behind the other two were goats. Okay, literally, bah, you know, those kinds of goats. Yeah, and literal goats. I mean, this is not a figure of speech. It was literal barnyard animals. And yeah, and you would play this game. Although I should point out that this scenario that I just played out, and the scenario that I described here, technically, this is what we would call an idealized version of what happened on the game show. This is not exactly the way things played out, but it's sort of a math problem inspired by what happened on the game show. But funny thing, in the game as actually played on television, if you got to the end, and if there was a goat behind your door, you literally won the goat, okay? That's actually true. You could take the goat home with you if you wanted. But the producers, recognizing that maybe, you know, most people didn't want to take care of a goat, cute as they are, would offer you a consolation prize of $100 in cash, okay? And in the entire history of the show, no one ever opted for the goat, right? every single person took the cash, the records don't disclose what actually happened to the goats. In the talk earlier this afternoon, someone, a little kid asked me, she said she would have wanted the goat because then they could eat it. That's not very nice. It's a cute goat, right? Anyway, so, yeah. Okay, so, now why is this such a big deal, this problem? Well, the reason it's such a big deal is that it causes a lot of controversy, and that the answer that seems intuitively correct to most people is actually wrong. So I think what we should do is go through the possibilities here. We'll start with, it doesn't matter. This is the argument that most people give, okay? Most people, when confronted with this problem, say, okay, look, after Monty opens the door, okay, there are only 2 doors remaining, and either, you know, they're equally likely, you know, to contain the car. So it's just 50-50 at that point. I have 2 doors. I should just toss a coin. And if you go by that logic, it just doesn't matter. Switch, stick, who cares, right? Now this, as intuitively appealing as this is, this of course is not correct, okay? And I will try to persuade you of that. If you do follow this attitude, you're going to see a whole lot of this in your future. Yeah, that was. Yeah, I did a Google image search on sneering goat. And I mean, you can find anything on the internet. Okay, So let's see what can be said on behalf of other possibilities. Now, it turns out if you actually do this, if you round up a bunch of people, you know, non-mathematicians, and you get them to play the game, nearly everyone sticks. They actually did this on Mythbusters, if anyone saw that one, yeah. And as I recall, they got 20, like, normal people. By normal, I mean non-mathematicians. And, you know, and it was 20 and 0. It was all 20 of them stuck with their first choice. And a lot of psychologists and cognitive scientists, people who study how people reason about probability, have done this. And overwhelmingly, most people choose to stick. And if you ask them why, like, why did you choose to stick, this is usually the argument they give, is that, you know, if you switch and lose, you'll feel like such a chump, right? You know, that better just to avoid the possibility by sticking. And actually, there's a very deep psychological tendency embedded in this that's been documented many times, that if you take some action, and as a result of that action, you incur a loss, okay? You feel worse about it, right, than if you incur the same loss through inaction, right? Because if you take the action, you feel like you brought it on yourself, right? Whereas if, you know, if it happens without you taking action, it's like, well, you know, stuff happens, right? On the other hand, in the context of this problem, though, I think this is an easily refuted argument, right? Because the problem calls for maximizing your chances to win the car, not minimize your chances of feeling like a chump. So I'm going to have to whip this one out on you. Aww. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Probably that kid from the last talk would probably want to eat him too, right? But yeah. So yeah. Okay. So let's move on to the other possibility. Okay. Now, of course, you know, statistically speaking, you should switch. The person who switched and did not win got a little unlucky. But that's probability for you. And now this is the correct answer, right? And I suspect if you've heard anything about this problem, you know the correct answer is to switch. In fact, you double your chances of winning by switching. However, you know, the argument that's used to back that up is usually what I have here. And in fact, you'll even see this in some pretty highbrow books on probability theory. The argument is basically this. When you make that first choice, clearly the probability was 1/3 that door was the correct one. And that Monty, since we know, according to the rules of the game, Monty will never show you the car, okay? So then, because of that, he can't change that 1/3 probability. It's as if it's like 1/3 probability of being over here and 2/3 of being over here, right? So Monty's action couldn't possibly change that, so you win with probability 2/3 by switching. Now, that conclusion is correct, okay? But I do think the argument is incomplete, okay? I think there are some important bits of probabilistic reasoning that are left out of this, so I'm gonna have to square this as partial credit. I think sometimes my students think that the correct answer to a test question, say, is actually the starting point of a negotiation, right? And then we try to, you know, try to finagle some points. It's actually more than that, though, right? So it's not just that most people come up with the wrong answer to this question, because let's face it, that's most math problems, okay? Yeah, some people didn't like that one, okay? but tough crowd, right? So it's not just that people get it wrong, right? It's that people get angry about it, okay? In fact, my experience has been, when I've presented this to a lot of classes, my experience has been that you tend to get 5 stages of reaction. It starts with denial, right? There's no advantage to switching. That quickly turns to anger, right? You know, yeah, how dare you suggest there's an advantage to switching? And then we move on to bargaining. Well, you know, maybe we're both kind of right. Afraid not. And then we move on to depression, right? And especially if you're doing it in this class, quickly moves on to acceptance, right? Yeah. Yeah. Some students just get mired at whatever, right? And, you know, the more practical students worry about whether it'll be on the test. Yeah. The other reason this is a famous problem, right, is that the way this problem came to a popular audience was through a column in Parade magazine written by Marilyn Vos Savant, okay? And this was in 1990 that this happened. And Marilyn Vos Savant, like her gimmick was that apparently she had the highest tested IQ, in the world at that time. I don't know how credible that claim was, but whatever. That was the gimmick for the column. And it was a question and answer column. People would send her questions, and very often they were questions of a mathematical or scientific character. And she was actually pretty good about answering these kinds of questions. Well, someone sent this in. I mean, someone sent in the Monty Hall problem and said, what should I do? Should I stick or switch? And Marilyn Vos Savant gave the correct answer. Yeah, I see someone has the book back there. Marilyn Vos Savant gave the correct answer. And she said that you should switch, and you'll double your chance of winning. Now, of course, I mean, remember, this was not a math textbook that she was writing. I mean, this was for a popular audience. So she gave kind of a terse explanation of it. But basically, she was right. I mean, she got the right answer, and her reasoning was basically correct. Well, not everyone agreed, okay? And Parade magazine was deluged with literally thousands of letters to the editor. This had just never happened before in the history of this column. With thousands of letters, most of them negative, and not just negative, but scathingly negative. So I couldn't resist including a few.
As a professional mathematician,
I'm sorry, it is impossible to read these without doing that voice, you know? you can just pick, please help by confessing your error in the future, being more careful, says,
But if it is any consolation, my academic colleagues have also been stumped by this problem.
You blew it, and you blew it big. There's enough mathematical illiteracy. Illiteracy, for heaven's sake, it's a probability problem, right? What a jerk, right? So this is before the internet, right? it's not like they just, they got annoyed and fired off a tweet, and that was the end of it, or they posted something to their blog or something like that. No, these people had to get out paper and write a letter, and fold it in thirds. Yeah, I see some kids in the audience who have no idea what I'm talking about. And, and stuff it in an envelope and put on a stamp and write an address and try to put it in a mailbox. And, you had to care that much, right? To be that rude, let's look at some more. However, in this matter, for which I do have expertise, obtain and refer to a standard textbook on probability before you try to answer a question. I believe that's called mansplaining, right? Be corrected by at least three mathematicians. You still don't see your mistake. And this is my favorite, right? If all those PhDs were wrong, the country would be in some very serious trouble. The Trump campaign in a nutshell, right? Okay, stay off politics. I'm sorry? Actually, the thing that this always reminds me of is in 1976, Richard Dawkins, the biologist, wrote a book called The Selfish Gene that caused some controversy. And a major philosophy journal, now this is an academic journal I'm talking about, published a very lengthy review of the book, a very critical, scathing review by a philosopher named Mary Midgley. The review was really rude. For an academic journal, this was really, it was surprising that the journal published it, really, that it was that rude. But worse than that, it was insane. It was the criticism just had nothing to do with what Dawkins actually said. It was really crazy. So Dawkins was given a chance to reply, and he had a line in his reply that just keeps coming back to me every time, because it's just so perfect. He said, we're in danger of thinking that no one would dare to be so rude without first taking the elementary precaution of being right. And that's what I think when I see this. It's like, if you're gonna be this passionate about it, be right. But the funny thing is, the problem actually has a long history dating back before Marilyn Vos Savant. Probably the first time it reached wide public attention was from Martin Gardner. Of course, with any mathematical topic, if you suggest that Martin Gardner was the one who brought it to a wide audience, you'll probably be right. He did this in one of his real early Scientific American columns in 1959. Now, of course, that was well before Let's Make a Deal existed, but a problem that was mathematically identical to the Monty Hall problem, called the Three Prisoners problem, was kind of going the rounds. And down here, this is John Maynard Smith, a fairly prominent biologist of the 20th century, and he wrote this in a book called Mathematical Ideas in Biology. And in the chapter on probability, he presents the Monty Hall problem, and he says, this should really be called a share baloney problem, since it nearly wrecked a conference on theoretical biology in the summer of 1966. So I guess it's not just the mathematicians, the biologists won in. Now this fellow here is Paul Erdős, one of the true legends of mathematics. He got it wrong. Erdős got it wrong. You have no idea how comforting this is to me, right? This guy's one of the giants. There's thousands of papers have his name on it. He invented whole branches of mathematics. He couldn't figure this out. And I love this line. This comes from one of the biographies that was written about him. And he said, but Erdős, to my surprise, said, oh, that is impossible. It should make no difference. At this point, I was sorry I brought up the problem, because it was my experience that people got excited and emotional about the answer, and I end up with an unpleasant situation. Erdős, this fellow down here is Massimo Piattelli Palmarini, who's a fairly prominent cognitive scientist. He wrote a book called Cognitive Illusions. Okay, so we know about optical illusions, right? They fool the eye. So he coined the term cognitive illusion for something that fools the brain. And he has this great line: the phenomenon is particularly interesting precisely because of its specificity, reproducibility, and its immunity to higher education. Right? Yeah. So yeah. Now I could have mentioned that one more incident that I might have mentioned was in 1975. Right, the first time it was actually called the Monty Hall problem was actually in 1975 in a professional statistics journal, the American Statistician. And it was a fellow named Steve Selvin just wrote a letter to the editor. And it was just an innocuous little thing. He wrote a letter to the editor saying, hey, here's an interesting little probability exercise I like to use with my students. The answer is kind of counterintuitive. Maybe other people would want to use it as well. And he describes the situation and then says, well, of course, the correct answer is to switch. What do you suppose happened next? Yeah, letters to the editor like that journal had never seen before. Of them saying, what are you, crazy? It's 50-50. Anyone can see that. What's wrong with you? And then that went through several rounds. And that was a professional journal, which is funny, you know, because it's a hard problem, but it's not that hard. You know, if you have some training in this subject, right, you shouldn't be that ostentatiously wrong about it. Okay, so yeah. So I think the next question is, how do we establish the correct answer here? Well, the thing that convinces almost everyone is that, you know, especially with a computer, it's very easy just to simulate the game. So you can very quickly just play the game over and over again and follow different strategies. And that's what I did here. And you'll have to just take my word for it that this data was generated honestly. But in these first 500 trials here, I stuck with my original choice every time. And the probabilities say you should win 33.3% of the time, but because I am that good, I won 34% of the time. Thank you. I'm a highly trained math professional, okay? Yeah, yeah, you should, something for you to aspire to. On the other hand, I underperformed when I stuck every time, right? It should be 66.6, and I tapped out at 64.2. I seem to have gone down between 400 and 500. Oh, I guess I was getting tired. Okay, so yeah. Yeah, now that's very convincing. Also, by the way, the fancy term for this is a Monte Carlo simulation, which is a term you'll see in probability theory textbooks. It's basically just a fancy word for saying, just do it over and over again and see what you get, named after the famous casino in Monte Carlo. Now that's very convincing. I mean, I think you look at that data and you say, okay, you know, the numbers don't lie. You know, switching is the way to go. But I don't think it really sheds much light on why. You know, switching is the way to go. So it's very convincing if you just want to know what the right thing to do is. But mathematically, it's maybe not satisfying. Here's a fairly simple way you can model it. If you imagine making a distinction between the two goats, so that we have goat one and goat two, then you can just what we, you know, the fancy term would be enumerate the sample space, right? But basically, you're just listing all the possibilities. Okay, and then you can just, you know, play out the different scenarios, and I think you'll find that in 4 cases out of 6, you would win by switching, and in 2 cases out of 6, you would lose by switching. Okay, and that's pretty convincing, I think. But I think we're going to go a little bit farther, right? Because I think what we're really after is it's not just the Monty Hall problem. We want to think clearly about conditional probability, and that's what this is, right? What's the probability that the car is behind my door, given that I just saw Monty open some other door? That's the question you're trying to answer. Now, the main tool that we use in mathematics to answer questions like that is Bayes' theorem. That's Mr. Bayes there, right? More precisely, that's what comes up if you do a Google image search on Thomas Bayes. So maybe it's him. I don't know. Right? But I mean, it's on the internet, so it must be true, right? Yeah. So, but anyway, I'm going with that. That's it. That's Bayes. Okay, so the notation here, basically what that means is the probability of A given B equals this formula. Now, this is the kind of thing that would be proved early on in a textbook on probability theory. It's something that's it's a relatively easy proof from the basic definitions of the subject, and we can certainly take that approach, I suppose. But I think it's better to think about what this is really saying. You know, one thing I like to tell my students is that equations are sentences. Okay? You know, often if you have too many symbols on a page, they say it in English. That is English. Okay? That's a perfectly good sentence. It has a subject, a verb, and everything. And yeah, so anytime you're confronted with an equation, I think it's always good to ask yourself, what is it saying, right? What is this claiming? And I think a good way to think about what Bayes' theorem is really saying is think in the context of, say, evidence in a criminal investigation. You know, when is something good evidence? So you have a question like, what's the probability that the suspect is guilty given that we found his fingerprints at the scene? That's a typical question you might want to answer. So the question is, under what circumstances are the fingerprints good evidence? Well, one thing you would want is you want to be able to say that the probability of finding the fingerprints at the scene, given that he's guilty, that reverse conditional probability there, you want that to be high. In other words, it's good evidence if it's something that's very likely to be true if the person is guilty. That's going to be part of it. But that's not enough, right? That by itself doesn't make it good evidence, right? Because for all you know, it might be this might be the kind of thing where it's very likely to occur regardless of whether the suspect is guilty. So let's say, in the example of the fingerprints, yeah, if the suspect is guilty, it's very likely that he will leave his fingerprints at the scene, but maybe he has some totally innocent reason for also being there, so of course you're going to find his fingerprints at the scene. And that's that probability of B term down at the bottom. So the way something is good evidence is if, it's good evidence if the suspect is, if the evidence is very likely given the assumption that the suspect is guilty and very unlikely otherwise. You kind of want both of those. And ultimately, if you parse the notation and you trace out the fraction there, that's really what it's saying. Okay. So Now we're also going to need this gadget. This is called the law of total probability. I think again, rather than try to explain this in the abstract, when we come to the point where we need it, I think it will become clear what that means. However, I did not have a graphic to go along with this slide, so that's a picture of my cat, Emily. Yeah. Yes. Careful study of this picture reveals that Emily is very cute. Yeah. I should probably keep her away from who. Anyway, I don't want to go there, right? I'm still picturing that poor goat that she won. Time for some applied math, okay? I was at an airport today, right? So here's a very practical problem I think we all face. You're at the airport baggage carousel waiting for your bag to appear. At what point do you start to worry that your bag is lost, okay? Now if you're like me, it's like three bags, okay? Yeah. It's like, three bags come, and it's like, that's it, my trip is ruined, right? And although I did one time, it did happen, my bag, first one out, right? We're all standing there, my cute little blue duffel bag came out, said, excuse me, had to muscle my way to the front, picked it up, went out, got the good cab, right? And felt real good about myself. That only happened once. That doesn't happen. At what point do you start worrying? We'll make a few simplifying assumptions here. Let's assume there are exactly 100 bags, okay? Because by making that assumption, we don't have to make a distinction between the number of bags and the percentage of bags. So just a little simplification there. We also want to have some knowledge about how often does it happen that airlines lose their luggage. So I looked up some statistics online, and I found like the worst airlines lose about 2% of the bags. It was actually, in fairness, it was slightly less than 2. I rounded off to get 2. It was Southwest, if you're wondering. But that's the absolute worst. I mean, the airlines have gotten pretty good, actually, at handling these bags. And we need some notation. I'm a mathematician. We need notation. So I'll use LB there to denote the event that the bag is lost. And I'll use not X to denote your bag is not among the first X. So given that, that's the problem we're trying to do. What is the probability that your bag is lost given that it is not among the first X? Okay. And now if you just whip out Bayes' theorem, you get this. And it's that probability of not X term on the bottom of the fraction. That's the tricky part. And the reason that's tricky is that there are two ways for your bag to not be among the first X. Right? Maybe it's not among the first X simply because it's later in line, right? And maybe it's not among the first X because the bag is actually lost. And this down here, that's the law of total probability. It's basically saying you need a weighted average over all those possibilities. Okay. Now again, I don't want to belabor the details of how you assign the numbers to each place. Suffice it to say that when you do the calculation, the answer turns out to be that thing on the bottom. The probability that your bag is lost, given that it is not among the first X, is that 200 over 10,000 minus 98X. Now, for the students in the audience, anytime you're working out a problem like this and you produce a formula, you always want to check it for extreme cases, okay? Cases where you know the answer. So when X is 0, okay, before any bags have come, you should think that the answer to this is 2%, right? The base rate at which bags are lost, and that sure enough is the case. If X is 0, you get 200 over 10,000, that is in fact 2%. Okay, on the other hand, if you go all the way to the end, if X is 100, right, all the bags have come, and your bag is not there, okay, then it's lost, okay? that's the definition of lost, right? So that's probability 1, and if X is actually 100, you get 10,000 minus 9,800, which really is 200. So at least it gives the correct answer in cases where we know the correct answer. So now the question is, what value of X will give you a probability greater than 1/2? Turns out it's 98, okay? And that's just to get a probability greater than 1/2, Okay? So so basically, when should you start to worry? When all the bags have appeared and yours is not there. Okay? That's when you start to worry. I have never met anyone who does that, though. I mean, most people just start getting antsy, you know, real fast. And it gets worse, right? This is the difference between pure math and applied math, right? Because if you've ever been in this situation, you know that there's always that pause in the middle, right? You know, the bags are coming, right? And then they stop coming. You're like, wait a second, there's more coming. That wasn't enough bags, right? You know, right, that would be more. And you wonder, and you're like, about it, like, the, you know, the baggage handler was time for their break, because you don't know what's going on back there. It's just the bags appear through a hole in the, you know, the thing. You have no idea what's going on, right? So, you know, I mean, it reminds me, there was that old Samsonite luggage commercial, right, where they were showing how tough their luggage was, and they would show the baggage handlers handling, and they would just let a gorilla play with it, and the gorilla would jump on it and throw it around, and Samsonite luggage could withstand that. It makes you wonder, like, gee, maybe they're really doing that. Okay, so applied math, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, so let's whip out the weapons here, as I like to say, and hit the Bayes' theorem with this. Now, again, I'm not going to belabor all the little details here. My notation here is that C1 indicates that the car is behind door 1. M2 indicates that Monty opened door 2. So you're asking yourself, what's the probability that the car is behind door 1, given that Monty just opened door 2? Okay, so you whip out Bayes' theorem. You use the law of total probability on the bottom. And the point is, we know most of the values for this problem. Right, the probability that the car is behind door 1, door 2, or door 3 is 1/3. The doors are equally likely. That was actually built into the statement of the problem at the start. Okay, so those terms are all easy to assign. The rules of the game also allow us to assign these conditional probabilities, right? So remember, the way I actually stated this, you started by choosing door 3. So the probability, so let's think about this. You're on door 3. In this scenario, the car is behind door 1. The rules of the game say Monty must open door 2. And that's why the probability of M2 given C1 is 1. And likewise, if the car is actually behind door 2, it's probability 0 that he will open that door. Which means, and this is kind of the punchline, it all comes down to this, okay? The probability that the car is behind door 1, given what Monty did, it all comes down to that conditional probability there. What's the probability of Monty doing what he did, given an assumption about where the car is, okay? Now, if you read that first slide very carefully, I explicitly stated that in this scenario, when Monty has a choice of doors to open, he flips a coin. He chooses randomly. In other words, that missing term will have value 1/2 in this case. Yeah, and if you plug in 1/2, you get the correct answer of 2/3. But if you make other assumptions about how Monty does his deciding, right, that probability will not be 1/2 anymore, and you will not get 2/3. Okay, so we'll consider that in a moment. That's my other cat. You know, Spider. Yeah. It seems a little dim up here. I don't know how that looks on the other screens. Spider is there sitting on his favorite suitcase. If you look off the side there, you can see that lovely cat bed I got him. Spider will sleep on any flat surface except that bed, okay? He especially likes that suitcase. If you look carefully, you can see the coating of cat hair. I no longer use that suitcase for traveling because Spider likes it so much. Okay, so yeah. Okay, so here's the take-home message, right? The take-home message is not really the technical minutia of the calculations, right? The take-home message is this. The reason most people get this wrong is that when they see Monty open door number 2, they think, I now know that door number 2 is wrong, but I have not learned anything else of relevance, okay? And that's what leads you to the it doesn't matter argument, okay? The correct way of thinking about it is that when Monty opens door 2, you say, I have just witnessed that event that is twice as likely to occur given the assumption that the car is behind door 1 than when the car is behind door 2. And that's the point, right? You have learned more than just door 2, that just door 2 is incorrect. You have learned that Monty, who makes his decisions in a particular way, right, chose to open that door, okay? And that's why you actually get more information than you think you do about the location of the car. Okay, so let's see if we really grok this. Let's try random Monty. Okay, so this time, Monty just chooses his door randomly. You pick a door, and then Monty just picks one of the other two doors without any regard to what's behind it. Okay, he won't pick your door, but he will pick one of the other two, and if it happens to reveal the car, then the game just ends early. Okay, so let's imagine you're playing this version of the game. You choose door 1, Monty opens door 2, and it happens to reveal a goat. Stick or switch?
It doesn't matter.
In this case, it doesn't matter. Okay, yeah, right? So, after you do the classic Monty Hall problem, people get the idea that switching is just inherently good, right? And you should just do it as often as possible. But no, in this case, the 50-50 argument is actually correct. And the idea is that the event we witnessed, right, when Monty opened door 2, given the rules of this game, that is equally likely to occur whether the car is behind door 1 or behind door 3, okay? And that's why we really don't get any information this time around. You could also just run it through Bayes' theorem. If you plug all the correct numbers into the correct places, this time the probability of winning by switching is just 1/2, okay? And let's do one more variation before we sum this up. So this one will be 3 obsessed, Monty. Where'd my cards go? Yeah. So this time, maybe this one's easier to illustrate. Basically, what I have in mind here is that most of the rules are the same. Monty will not open your door, okay? He will not open the door that reveals a car, but we have an additional rule. He will always open this door when he can, okay? So now let's imagine the situation, okay? You pick, I'll put the prize over here, right? So let's say you pick this one initially, and then Monty shows you this one. You'll say to yourself, wait a second. Why didn't he show me this one? Monty always shows me this one whenever he can. And now I didn't choose it. That's not why he didn't show it to me. The only reason he wouldn't show me this door if this has the prize. So at this time, if this is the way it plays out, you'll win with probability 1 by switching. You'll say, yeah, it's a switch, and no suspense, right? You win. On the other hand, if we now imagine maybe I should do it this way. If we now imagine that the prize is in the middle and you pick this door initially, well, now he'll just show you this one. But now you really haven't learned anything, right? That's something he would have done regardless of where the prize was. Whether the prize was behind door number 1 or door number 2, he's going to open this one. And now it's 50-50, which means that in this version of the game, the probability that you win by switching is either 1, you either definitely win, or it's 50-50. So what this shows is that Monty's selection procedure is critical, okay? This is why it's not sufficient to say nothing Monty does can change that 1/3 probability of your initial door because he's always guaranteed to reveal a goat, right? Especially in 3 obsessed Monty, right? It was guaranteed he would show you a goat, and yet what he did change the probability of your original door, and that's the key thing to realize, okay? And here are the cats eating tuna fish together, and they don't like each other. Okay, but yeah, it's very sad. They tolerate each other, right? But they don't like each other. But tuna fish can unite them, right? That's when they'll tolerate being this close. Now, some of this might remind you of a game show that was on a number of years ago called Deal or No Deal, okay? And actually, a student asked me about this after I presented the Monty Hall problem in class once. And this is how the game begins. You have 26 briefcases there. And inside those briefcases are different amounts of money, okay, ranging from 1 penny to $1 million, okay? You want the million, okay? Well, sometimes you have to stipulate that. Okay, so the way the game works is, the way the game works is you pick one of the cases at random, okay? And that case gets put off to the side unopened, okay? And you then open 6 cases at random. Okay? Now, depending on what you find in those cases, you learn something about what's in your case, right? If you reveal small amounts of money, right, then the probability that there's a big amount of money in your briefcase goes up, okay? And that's good, okay? On the other hand, if you reveal big amounts of money, then it's more likely that there's a small amount of money in your briefcase. Okay, now after you do 6, the game is then paused, and the banker comes in and makes you an offer. He says, I'll give you $15,000 for your case right now. You have to decide, well, if I go further, am I more likely to reveal small amounts of money and get a better offer next time? And this is how it goes. You open more cases, you get another offer, you offer more open more cases, you get more money. Now, of course, at the start of the game, there are way more small amounts of money than big amounts of money, okay? So your chances are pretty good of revealing small amounts of money. Okay, but as you get fewer and fewer cases, they might say you only have to open up 1 more case, but the chances that you're going to reveal the $1 million goes up. Okay, so you keep doing this. And nearly always what would happen in this game is that by the time you get down to 4 or 5 briefcases, the contestant had enough and would just take the offer. And generally, the offer would be a little less than the expected value. That's a term from probability theory. But really, we just mean the average in this case of what's left. Okay, but here's the thing. If the game actually got down to 2 cases, okay, you were given the option of sticking with your original case or switching to the other case. Okay, so let's imagine that there were two amounts left. Let's say it's the dollar and the $1 million that are still still in play at that point. Should you stick or switch? Doesn't matter. Yeah, we're playing random, Monty, right? Because at every single point in the game, there was some probability that the $1 million would be revealed. Okay, and that affects the probability. But maybe a better way to see it is to ask yourself this. You say, okay, look, I want the $1 million, so let's see, the probability that my case had the $1 million you might think was 1/26, okay? So it's like 25/26, that it's the other one, so I should switch. That's a wrong argument, right? But if you thought that was correct, what would you do if you actually wanted the $1 for some reason, okay? You'd go through exactly the same argument, right? And suddenly the conclusion would be, whatever you want, switch, okay? And that just doesn't seem credible, okay? And again, this is really random, Monty, that we're playing. But it was interesting that it was actually a student who raised this question to me. And okay. So yeah, oh, so yeah, that's what I just said. Okay, let's kick this up a notch. This time, Classic Monty and Three Obsessed Monty are backstage and they flip a coin to decide who goes out. But you don't, right? But you don't know which host you got, okay? Yeah. So, so you choose door one and Monty opens door three. What do you do? Okay. So, Oh, by the way, what should I do?
Switch.
Yeah. What's the probability that I win by switching?
75%.
Whoa. You went with probably 3/4 or 5/6? Goodness. Okay. I hope that's not right, because that's not the answer I have, right? So, by the way, though, this might be a good time to raise another issue. Anytime you see this problem expressed in, like, a probability book or whatnot, it's essentially expressed in this way. In other words, it's always presented as a problem in decision theory. What should you do?
Yes?
7/12. Okay, we're getting there. It's always presented in this way. Okay, so it's a problem with decisions. So like, especially in the original Monty Hall problem, you might say, well, wait a minute. You know, there's no argument that you could hurt yourself by switching. No one ever argues that. So you might say, if your only interest is in making a decision, you might say, well, I can't hurt myself by switching, and I might help myself, so the decision is clear. And that's true if you view it as a problem in decision theory. But when mathematicians discuss this problem, we usually have something else in mind. Okay, usually what we want is to be able to assign the correct probability to each door at every stage of the game. Okay, so with that in mind, let's see what happens here. If you have not been paying close attention, you might argue like this. You say, well, if I've drawn Classic Monty, then I win with probability 2/3 by switching, right? That was the first few slides, right? With Three Obsessed Monty, in this exact scenario, I win with probability 1/2. So I should just average them, and then I'll get 7/12. Is that how you got 7/12? Yeah. No. Okay, so, So I think that I think you've overlooked something, right? Which is that we actually got more information than we actually got more information than you might think, okay? And the reason is that once we see Monty open one of the doors, we learn something about which Monty we got, okay? And that has to be factored in, okay? So you say, well, wait a minute. Classic Monty opens door 3 with probability 1/2. That is true. And Three Obsessed Monty opens door 3 with probability 2/3. That is also true. So I have just witnessed an event that is 4/3 more likely to occur under one of the hosts than the other host, okay? So that means that the probabilities I should assign, like if I say, what's the probability I got Three Obsessed Monty versus Classic Monty, it's gonna have to preserve that ratio. That's ultimately a consequence of Bayes' theorem, but I think that there's enough plausibility in that I won't try to prove it. Okay, so you should now think that the probability that you got Three Obsessed Monty that you got Three Obsessed Monty with probability 4/7 and Classic Monty with probability 3/7. So what you want is not the average, but really the weighted average of those two. And the calculation works like this. So you should switch, okay? The probability that you win by switching is actually 4/7, okay, in this case, a perfectly fine fraction. Okay, you ready for the final exam? Okay. This one gets a little complicated, okay? And I'm gonna go through it a little bit quickly. If you want to see the longer, more detailed version, I know a book you can read. And I'll tell you the story behind this problem. So now the idea is there are two players in the game, okay? You and someone else, okay? And each of you knows that there's another player in the game, okay? And you each choose a door, okay? But you don't know which door the other guy chose, okay? But Monty knows, okay? So Monty knows where the car is, and Monty knows the choices made by each player, right? Okay, so each player only knows his own choice, but Monty knows both choices. Now, Monty does one of two things. Okay, if the two players chose the same door, if it worked out that way, okay, then we're playing Classic Monty, okay? It says, he won't open your doors, he won't open the door with the car, and then, he'll always reveal a goat, and if he has a choice, he flips a coin. Okay, so if that happens, we're playing Classic Monty. If the two players chose different doors, okay, then Monty will simply open the other door regardless of what's behind it, okay? And if there's a car behind it, the game just ends. So be it, okay? Okay, you choose door one, Monty reopens door two and shows a goat. What do you do? Yeah, okay. Now, that's fiendishly clever. That's one of those problems where just thinking up the problem is kind of clever. So I should tell you where this came from, okay? I actually found this in a philosophy journal, okay? It was an article written by a philosopher, not specifically about the Monty Hall problem. He was trying to illustrate certain issues about interpretations of probability, which is kind of a big deal among philosophers, not so much among mathematicians, but there you go. And but anyway, so he wrote this very long article, and he included this version of the problem, okay? And and he had a discussion of the problem, and he came up to it with a certain answer, and then he moved on to other things. What do you think happened next, okay? Angry letters to the editor, right? You know, replies, and another philosopher actually wrote a paper, right, replying and saying, boy, that first guy, he has it all wrong. Here's a totally different solution to the same problem. And the funny thing, so I was reading this, and my attitude was the second guy was just flat wrong. The first guy had the right answer, but I felt his explanation was not convincing. So we're going to try to solve this version of the problem, but we're going to do it without Bayes' theorem. We're going to do it without any calculations. We're just going to intuit our way to the answer. There'll be a few calculations, but no, you know, just some fractions, right? Okay. So first of all, the first question you ask yourself is, what did the other player do? After you see Monty open his door, what have you learned about what the other player did? Okay. Well, there are only two possibilities, right? He either chose door one or door three, right? Monty opened door two. Okay. So the other guy didn't choose that one. Okay. So we only have these two possibilities. Okay. Well, if he chose door three, then the rules of the game say Monty is certain to open door two. Remember, I chose door one. If he chose door three, Monty is forced to open door two, and that's the end of it. Okay? And two-thirds of the time, that door will conceal a goat. Okay. Now, if he chose door one, now it gets tricky, because there are two more possibilities. Remember, I chose door one, he chose door one, Monty opened door two. Why did he do that? Okay? He might have done that because door three actually conceals the car, and then he's forced to open door two. Or it could be that door one conceals the car. So it's this big party at door one. I chose door one. The other guy chose door one. The car is there, okay? And now Monty can do what he wants with the other two doors. Okay, so we're going to have to consider both of those. Okay, well, let's see. The car is behind door one with probability one-third. Okay, that's basic. And Monty will then open door two with probability one-half. And this whole scenario, therefore, plays out with probability one-sixth. That's a basic fact about probabilities. You can multiply them like that. Now, if we analyze the other case, the car is behind door three with probability one-third, but Monty is now certain to open door two. So if we want to say what is the probability what's the probability of Monty doing what he did, given our assumption about player two there, we would add those together and find out get an answer of one-half. So the conclusion was this. The event I saw was Monty opens the goat-revealing door two, the goat-containing door two, okay? That happens with probability two-thirds, when player two chooses door three, and with probability one-half when Monty chooses door one. Okay. So therefore, it's the same ratios we had before, right? We should now conclude that player two chose door three with probability 4/7 and chose door one with probability 3/7. Again, the exact numbers are not what's important, right? What's important is that the event you witnessed is more likely to happen if player two chose door three than in the other case. And that's why you get more information than you think you might. Okay, but now it's easy, right? Because if you're keeping track of everything, there are only four scenarios left, and here they are. And if you just tally up which ones constitute winning by switching, it's actually those first two lines, okay? And so the middle two lines are the cases where, the middle two, not the top two, where we win by switching. They show that we win by switching with probability 4/7. Okay, so same answer as last time. But there you go. No Bayes' theorem, no elaborate proofs, nothing. The funny thing, though, right, is that if I chose door one and the other guy chose door three, we're both going to go through this reasoning. And we're both going to conclude that we will win with probability 4/7 by switching, right? So switch we will, right? But one of us has been making the wrong decision. But that's probability theory for you. So there we go. So I think it's time to wrap this up. Now, when I told people I was writing a book about the Monty Hall problem, I got a lot of funny looks. People would just say to me, a whole book? Just say, you should switch, right? And you're done, right? And very short book. So I got a kick out of telling people that actually I could easily have written a second book with all the material I left out of this one. It's actually funny these days. Doing research is not what it used to be. Now you just type names into the database and see what you get. But you have to be careful, right? Because one of the first things I did when I started my research for the book was I searched on Monty Hall in every search engine I could think of. And one of these was a medical database, and it popped out an article from the Journal of Neuropharmacology. And I thought, my goodness, the neuropharmacologists are discussing the Monty Hall problem. And I went to that paper, and it turned out they weren't discussing the Monty Hall problem. It was that the first author was named Monty, and the second author was named Hall. Right? Yeah. But I mentioned the article anyway, and it's in my bibliography. Yeah, so there. OK, so yeah. So if this talk were to go on forever, perhaps it seems like it's too late. But believe it or not, there's still more three-door versions, right? There is no end to the number. I mean, Monty can behave in some weird ways, right? If you have the urge to analyze them, right? So there are plenty more three-door versions. And there are also n-door versions of the game, right? Maybe you have 10 doors, okay? And you pick one, and then Monty shows you a goat, and then he gives you the option of sticking or switching. Okay, you make your choice. Then he reveals another goat, and he gives you the option of sticking or switching. And then he reveals another goat. This is sometimes called the progressive Monty Hall problem. And now the question is, what should you do? So now it's not stick or switch, it's what's your strategy, right? When should you switch? How many times should you switch? And the cool thing about this one is that if you do this problem with the class right after doing the first one, they'll say switch every time, okay? Because the lesson they learned from the first version had nothing to do with Bayes' theorem, nothing to do with thinking clearly about conditional probability. What they heard was switching is just inherently good, okay? And you should do it at every opportunity. But the cool thing about the problem is that that's actually not the best strategy. The best strategy, you might be able to quickly guess the best strategy, although proving it is a lot harder. But the best strategy is you stick with your first choice until you get to the end. Right, if you have 10 doors, that first door has probability 1/10. If you do the elaborate calculation, by that last door standing is going to have probability 9/10 of winning. So the cool part of the problem is first proving that. It seems intuitively to make sense, but how do you actually prove it? But more than that, why does it hurt you to switch earlier on? Right? Because it seems like as long as you switch at the end, that should be what matters. Right? But it turns out you actually do hurt yourself. And other cool things happen. If you imagine like the number of doors becoming infinite, this is the kind of weird thing mathematicians do. If you imagine the number of doors going to infinity, you take a limit. It turns out the limiting probability of winning if you switch every time is 1 minus 1 over e, which is bonkers, because where did e come from, right? Yeah. So this is the sort of thing that gets mathematicians excited. I actually got a paper out of this with a friend of mine at JMU. We wrote a paper about this. So it's like, yeah, we published, right? So we did not perish. Okay, so, that's the biz we're in. Okay, so, here's another one. What if you have many different kinds of prizes, a really valuable prize, a middle prize, and a low prize? Now this introduces the idea of expectation, or the expected value of a random variable, to use the jargon. And my original idea for this book was you could write a whole book on probability theory just by using variations on the Monty Hall problem. In other words, you're forced to consider all these standard ideas. But we're just getting started, lucky you. What is it? I told you the psychologists and the cognitive scientists get in on this. So what's it telling us about human reasoning that people get this wrong so often? The philosophers, throw in their two cents, but who cares about the philosophers? Am I right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. Oh, I kid the philosophers, right? Then of course, as a math educator, right? I mean, what sorts of presentations can we do to make it easier for students to get the hang of this? So there are all these different directions you can go in. That just about wraps it up. I just have one more slide. Bam. Right? Yeah. So if any of this was interesting to you, I know a good book you can read. I think there are still a few copies left over there. So anyway, thank you very much for your attention. And that's it.
All right. Well, if you're facing a difficult decision yourself and want to know which door to go through, you have a couple of minutes to ask some questions. And I see a hand that's been up there very faithfully. Please wait until I come. Please stand up and then say your question clearly into the mic.
In the two-player problem, who wins if they both get it right?
It's more of a theoretical problem. Yeah. So I don't know. Yeah. It's hard enough for one player to win.
I believe it was the situation you gave where you had two Monty Halls that could be chosen at random, classic Monty who would do things randomly, and you had three obsessed Monty.
Yes.
Okay. And as you went through that problem that way, I believe you got to a point where you said, therefore, the probability that you have this version of Monty is 4/7, and the probability that you have that version of Monty is 3/7.
Right.
Why didn't you stop there? Because that goes counter to the way you stated the problem in the first place.
So the point is, three obsessed Monty and classic Monty flipped a coin backstage to decide who goes on. But once you see, whichever host you got, once you see him do something, right, that gives you more information than you had before, right? So initially, you might think, okay, initially I might think it's 50-50 which one I got, but then because of new information that I received, I can update that probability and now say, okay, now based on what I just saw, I think it's more likely that I got three obsessed Monty than classic Monty. And in fact, that's exactly what Bayes' theorem does, right? It tells you how to update a prior probability distribution, right? Initially, all I knew was that it was 50-50, but then I got new information, and that allowed me to update my probabilities. So that's what was going on there. Yeah, I glossed over that point pretty quickly, but that's what it was, yeah.
Are you saying the player knows that he has the three obsessed Monty, and therefore he knows that Monty will always pick number three?
When I actually discussed three obsessed Monty, the understanding was that the player knows exactly what procedure Monty uses.
That changes the whole problem.
There were two different problems that involved three obsessed Monty, and I'm not sure which one you're talking about now.
The very first time you mentioned three obsessed,
okay.
You said the player knows it's three obsessed. He knows he always picks three, and therefore he knows that his choices are going to be
right.
Either one.
Yeah.
But then from the player's point of view, from a psychological point of view, he really doesn't know which one of the two doors has the car. So in his mind, the choice must necessarily always be 50-50.
I'm not quite following that, right? So, right, the idea of three obsessed Monty was that Monty will always open door three when he can.
Right.
Okay? So if I don't pick door three and Monty does not open door three, right, then the only reason he would not have opened door three is if door three conceals the car. So, for example, in that scenario, I would know for an absolute certainty.
So I thought you were saying he's three obsessed and always picks three.
No. He's three obsessed and always picks three when he can, subject to the other rules of the game. Yeah, even three obsessed Monty will still never show you the car, and he will still never pick the door that you chose initially. Okay, if given those constraints, he can still pick door three, then he will. Okay, and that's why if he doesn't, right, then you know that the car must be behind door three. But on the other hand, if he does, right, then it's 50-50. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Why is it that choosing to switch early in the progressive Monty game is...
Why does that hurt you? You're trying to force Monty to give you information about where the car is, okay? And so the way you're going to do that is that you want to force Monty to open doors that you think have a relatively high probability of being correct, right? So for example, let's take a really extreme version where there are 100 doors, okay? And you pick door number one. Okay, so we're playing progressive Monty with 100 doors. And you pick door number one, and Monty now opens door two and shows you that there's a go. Now, if you leave door number one, okay, let's say I switch to door three, I'm giving Monty the opportunity to open door one. And door one has probability 1 out of 100 of being correct. So I'm giving Monty the opportunity to show me that a door that I was really pretty certain didn't contain the car actually doesn't contain the car. If I sit on that choice, all the other doors have a higher probability of being correct. And therefore, when Monty opens one of those doors, he's giving you more information than you had before. The basic insight, there's actually a branch of mathematics called information theory. And the basic insight of information theory is that you learn more when a low probability event happens than from a high probability event happens. And that's essentially what you're saying. You want to force Monty to open the doors that in your mind have the highest probability of being correct. And any door you chose early in the game is going to have a lower probability than that. And that's why you don't quite extract as much information as you could if you switch too soon. Yeah. Now, the probability doesn't go down by much, you know, if you switch too soon, but it does go down a little bit.
In the three obsessed Monty,
uh-huh.
Do you have an advantage if you choose three or if you don't choose three?
I think you're better off not choosing three, right? Because if you do choose three, then you know Monty can't choose door three, and you just learn nothing.
Yeah, that would just be the possibility.
Pretty much, yeah. So you really like that possibility where the car really is behind door three, and Monty can't open that door, right? You really want that possibility. So I would say don't pick door three
but,
in that case.
Editorial privilege here. Mm-hmm. In the case that you pick door three, don't you always have a 2/3 chance of getting it right? And so you're trading off always having a 2/3 chance versus...
Why do you have a 2/3 chance of getting it right?
Well, aren't you back to classic Monty if you've picked three?
Well, not quite. So let's see. If you pick door three, then Monty will open door one or door two I see what you're saying. Okay, so, yeah. Okay, so, you're saying that we're playing classic logic, so you'll win with probability 2/3 by switching.
Always.
Yeah, whereas if you don't pick door number 3, you either win with probability 1 or 1/2. Right.
Right.
So that's an interesting question. So which is better, right?
Yeah, which is better?
What, I do all the work? I mean, you know, it's I wrote the book, you know, right? Write your own book.
That's on page 47, guys, in case, in case you're looking for it. All right, did you have a question? Right here, yeah, please stand.
I'm a little confused about the scenario you talked about where two people are playing, and they each pick a different door, and Monty picks the third door. So there's a 4/7 chance if you switch. But I have a 4/7 chance, and so does the other guy. So how could we both have a 4/7 chance?
What's the problem? Yeah, so that 4/7 represents the probability that you'll win by switching from the door you originally chose to the other door, right? But that's independent of which door you initially chose, right? So in other words, the door you initially chose means different things to the two players, right? So, I think there's just no contradiction there, right? Each person will very rationally assess this probability of winning by switching at 4/7, some of the time the first player will be wrong, and some of the time the second player will be wrong. I think that it might seem paradoxical, but I just don't see a contradiction there. Yeah.
It seems like this has a lot of application with like decision-making theory and stuff like that, and like incorporating Bayes' theorem. Mm-hmm. In your research, have you found anything to do with incorporating this in like modern technology?
I personally have not, but I should emphasize that the kind of research I normally do is really not this. I work in an area called combinatorics, specifically something called algebraic graph theory, and writing this book was really quite a departure from anything I normally do. To the extent that there's a distinction between pure mathematics and applied mathematics, I am definitely on the pure side. I'm the kind who loses interest when you tell me what you can do with the math, right? I think that's like asking, what do you do with a great painting, right? You know, it's like if you say, oh, so it's a very useful painting, you can use it to level off a table. You might think that person's missing the point. I'm really not the one to ask about that. Your point is well taken, though, because this is what decision theory is. But I'm not the one to ask about that. Yeah.
Okay. I think you mentioned when you did your 500 samples that you used a computer.
Yes.
So let's suppose theoretically you had two computer programmers, and one, his level of thinking was, I'm a sticker, and the other person's level of thinking was, I'm a switcher. Even though they're not thinking about this problem, could they, theoretically be programming your program incorrectly so that it would prove a point? And then if that's also, if Bayes' theory, and you're relying on it, but what if theoretically it was not accurate? Like before we thought everything was solid, and now we, there's, space between atoms. What if one day from 500 years in the future, someone came here and gave you Bayes' theorem plus? So do you think
you
really proved your point?
That's trippy. Yeah. Yeah. Certainly, when you're relying on a computer simulation, there certainly is always the danger that there was some error in the code. I mean, the particular simulation I use is one that's readily available online, and I was kind of just trusting, that it was, done correctly. It did generate the correct data. However, I can give you a stronger answer for Bayes' theorem. Ultimately, Bayes' theorem is just a logical deduction from the definitions of probability, right? You have certain fundamental axioms of probability. Bayes' theorem is just an immediate consequence of that. So in that sense, it really can't be wrong, right? I mean, it is right in the sense that it is a logical deduction from those axioms. So the question would be, are those axioms useful? Right, for modeling probability, problems in probability theory, and all I can say is that they have a pretty good track record. So I'm gonna stick with Thomas Bayes or whoever that was on that slide, I'll think about the issue of the people coming from the future when I'm on the plane tomorrow, I think I'll leave it there for now. Interesting question. Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you.